Good afternoon. My name is Jessica Jensen. I am the Chief of Staff at Young America's Foundation. I am honored to introduce the moderator of our next session. Both of the ladies you'll hear from today are accomplished leaders and incredible advocates for our shared cause, and we are thrilled to have them with us. We'd also like to welcome all of the viewers who are watching us on C-SPAN. Kate Obenshain has a long history with Young America's Foundation. She is an alumnus of our programs. She has been a popular speaker for more than 25 years, and she has served as both a vice president and as a director of the foundation. She is also a frequent Fox News guest and author. In addition, Kate has been the chief of staff for Senator George Allen and was the first woman chair of the Virginia GOP. However, among her many accomplishments, I would guess Kate is most proud to be the mother of six children. Please join me in welcoming Kate Obenshain.
Okay, I'm beside myself. I'm so excited about this. I usually have to stand up here and talk, and y'all all get sleepy looking. That's not going to happen today because I have the pleasure of introducing to you someone who is a good friend of mine, but I have admired her for decades. And when it was announced that this lady was going to take over running the Trump campaign, I, somebody who had been a little, not sure, was in. Completely. I had complete confidence at that point. Kellyanne Conway is counselor to the President of the United States of America. She is... She is the first woman ever to successfully run a presidential campaign. Is the co-author of What Women Really Want. You know, we conservative women know what women really want. She has appeared on thousands of television programs. This year, she was Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute's Woman of the Year. She has been president and CEO of her own company, The Polling Company. And on top of that, she is an amazing mother of four children. Now, the Toronto Sun called her the hero that feminism ignores. I wonder why. Jonah Goldberg said of Kellyanne, because of the unprecedented and frankly sexist attacks that she has been sustaining, that she is, Kellyanne Conway is good at her job and the media hate her for it. Well, we love her, and I ask you to join me in welcoming a true hero and a great champion of freedom, Kellyanne Conway. It's like a rock concert. If she walks down there, it'd be awesome, right? That is such a nice... Hello, yeah. Kellyanne, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank
We're so
Kate.
Happy. As
that
you can tell,
a lovely
I'm beside
introduction
myself.
That my mother wrote,
Aww.
I guess.
I know. She and I are like this. It's really great. No, you're amazing. You have this ridiculous resume. I mean, it is so impressive. Phi Beta Kappa from Trinity College. George Washington School of Law. She graduated with honors. That's right. Yay, yay. You have been president of a multi-million dollar company, The Polling Company. And I just think it's amazing that nobody mentions this, of course, in the media, but you are the first woman to successfully run a presidential campaign. Now, I have known you for years and have been always so impressed with your grasp of trends and polling. You're one of the smartest people I have ever met, but you are definitely the best in the country at understanding these trends. How did your background with polling help you in the presidential campaign? And basically, tell us a little bit about what that was like running that campaign.
Kate, first of all, thank you. And thanks to Young America's Foundation, to Ron Robinson, I think one of the longest serving leaders in the conservative movement in one consistent position, which is very rare these days. And I also just want to take an opportunity to thank each of you, certainly for being here, but just for being such loud voices for freedom and democracy and free markets and national security and prosperity, and for really standing your ground. I know how difficult it may be, but it's fun and it's worth it, and she's not the president, so let me answer that question. So to answer your question, I actually think that it was very helpful to be a data specialist and become campaign manager. Why? Because in politics, true political pollsters, they only know what voters think and what voters are doing. So we're missing basically half of the country. And in presidential elections, about a third of the country or 25% of the country. So part of the job was to understand how people really felt about issues and themes outside of the electoral context. I'll give you a couple good examples. One is, instead of just talking about job creators or job seekers, so the Republican Party for a long time was talking about entrepreneurs and job creators, the famous "you didn't build that"
right.
meme in the convention.
Right.
And I think that's fine, check, check, job creators. I was one for 21 years, entrepreneurs, but that's about 7% of the country. Another 7% or so of the country are job seekers. But we need to talk to the vast majority of households that are neither job creators nor job seekers, but are job holders. Because it's the job holders that are saying, wow, we have 2 in 3 jobs in our household. We're not worried about losing the job or replacing the lost job. But why is the job not enough to get ahead? Why am I white-knuckled at the end of each month to pay these bills to decide whether my child can afford a community college or the 4-year college that he or she was welcomed into? Also recognizing that themes motivate voters, not necessarily just issues. So I think one thing Donald Trump did masterfully was elevate the theme of fairness. And he did that without really saying the word that often. An example would be how he wants to reform the tax code to make it more fair and simple and to give people relief. Another example is his views on school choice and charters. That is it fair? You're just asking somebody, is it fair that a child goes to school based on his zip code? Or where she lives. He also, I think, elevated the issue of fairness by changing the way we looked at trade and immigration. Trade was such an unsexy issue, it wasn't even mentioned in most polling choices. And yet he took this issue of trade and basically said, it's not fair to America and American workers that we make these one-sided trade deals. No wonder the other countries love us. They're taking us to the cleaners every single time. So he wants something that's more fair. And perhaps the best example of it is his views toward immigration, where for years this country was asking what's fair to the illegal immigrant. And he changed that to what's fair to the American worker that may be competing with that immigrant for the job, or what's fair to the local resources, what's fair to a sovereign nation that should have borders. We had spent billions of dollars helping other countries protect their borders, and he just figured it's fair and it's high time we do that here. Data also helped me to understand the difference between biased questions, which are easy to detect, and useless questions, which are not easy to detect, but which were sucking the lifeblood out of Republican presidential politics, in my view. So a useless question is, for example, do you support or oppose protecting the environment? It's like, well, it'll say 88%. I'm like, well, who the heck were the other 12%? You know, that's silly, but that wasn't, somebody would look at the 88% and go right for the liberal policies and try and be forced to adopt them as a Republican because they're not asking the tough questions beneath, which is, here are 4 views about how best to balance economic growth and environmental stewardship. I coined the term undercover Trump voter last July, right before I became campaign manager. I was already part of the campaign. And I coined this term undercover Trump voter and said that he was doing about 4 to 6 points better in most state polls. And I was literally universally ridiculed, right, as I said on a London station first, universally ridiculed. But it was my data background that helped me to realize that there were going to be people who had either never voted or had not voted, or had never voted Republican, who were going to vote for Donald Trump. And they were going to do that based on him coloring outside of the lines and getting out of the partisan comfort zone and reaching out to the forgotten man or forgotten woman and saying, you know, you are doing the best job you can, but you're forgotten by the special interests, the system, and the swamp. And we're here for you. I'm doing this for you to really appeal to people and have that connective tissue. He really is the best communicator I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. And it mattered to people. At the same time, and I want all of you to remember this as young conservatives, I'm still conservative, I'm just not young, I want you to remember this, which is he would not have gotten elected unless he had a program, unless he had run on issues. He's the best communicator ever. But it's the issues that he ran on. It was his message. If you can tell me what Hillary Clinton's message was, I'd love to know, because I'm still a year later wondering. Every day I'd wake up and I'd say, please, God, don't let this be the day that she gets an optimistic, positive, cohesive message. Please. And days would come and days would go and there would be no message other than he's bad and I'm not him, which is not a message, it's a screed. But it was his message, it was his program. Build the wall, cut taxes, repeal Obamacare, put ISIS in retreat on its way to defeat. Make America great again, but make it number one again. American exceptionalism. He ran for our veterans, the military, the taxpayers, the property owners, our first responders. And with specific, a 10-point program to reform the VA, one of, I think, his greatest sets of accomplishments in the first 6 months is so much that has been done for our veterans, for example. But the data background is important on the science side to recognize that there are people who call themselves Republicans or Democrats or undecided, and to make them feel comfortable to tell you that maybe they're going to be a little less comfortable in their voting behavior this time and go outside of the norms. And secondly, from the art perspective of the question wording, just to try to ask things a little bit differently so that people would feel comfortable to tell us. Maybe they don't know all the ins and outs of an issue, so that's an opportunity to help inform. Or maybe the answer is, oh, protect the environment, of course. Well, we all agree with that, but the question is how? How do you get there? And with what level of priority, with what level of, federal involvement in this case? So it was helpful, but I want the record to reflect it took Donald J. Trump to elevate a woman for the first time ever in the Republican presidential campaign dynamic. Without him, that would not have happened because it never had happened, and it wasn't happening with the other candidates. And I always want history to show that more than anything, which is that this man who was comfortable for decades elevating and promoting women to positions of power in New York real estate before it was cool to do so, certainly in the Trump Corporation, Trump campaign, Trump cabinet, and Trump West Wing.
Well, he sees quality and sees professionalism and excellence and did something about it. So we were all pretty happy that he recognized that in you. A lot of the young people in this room are Trump supporters and were Trump supporters. And I will tell you, they took a lot of heat on campuses. And they still do take a lot of heat. If you dare say, I support Donald Trump, then they come after you. And you're being vilified, just like what Obama did for 8 years. They're still doing it on campuses, probably more intensely than anywhere in the country, to you guys. So what advice do you have for these young people and Trump supporters out there who are still enduring this?
First of all, thank you. Thank you, obviously, for your support of the president, and I'm sure maybe there are some people in this room who don't always support us and what we're doing, or maybe had a different candidate last year in the primaries. But remember what President Trump said just as he was elected in those wee hours of November 9th. He took to the podium and he said, I will be the president of all Americans, including those who do not support me. And he's really made good on that. He has me working on the opioid crisis along with other people, obviously in the White House and the administration. And I've gone around the country and will continue to do that. I would never in a million years ask somebody, so did you vote for him? What are your politics? Are you registered to vote? You know, before we help you with the opioid crisis. So I know personally he doesn't feel that way. And I know that he believes some issues should prevail and others should fail. And he's made very clear as to why he's there. So I want you to remember that too. You should have a 7-second and a 70-second and a 7-minute version. And you should tell everybody this, whether they ask you the question or not. Answer the question, even when you're not asked. Why am I a conservative, or why am I a Trump supporter, or why am I on this side of that issue and not where everybody else seems to be? And tell them, because you have a couple things that I simply lack. One is the largest part of the future. You do. The future belongs to those who are the youngest. And you have the law. You will vote in more elections than any of the rest of us. You will be more involved in civic participation, in workplace participation, than those of us already decades into that. And the thing about you that's so unique and so important and consequential, I would say, is that you have an opportunity for somebody to look at you on your college campus, in your communities, in your extended family, anywhere where you happen to be, and they'll look at you and they'll say, you know, I like you and you're like me, so I'm listening. That connective tissue is so unique. And it's so powerful. And I would argue it's much more powerful than some random television appearance or a speech somebody gives or me with you today, because you are the best ambassadors for your peer group. And yes, it is tough. People will say, well, I can't believe you could support this, or I can't believe you're not a liberal like us. And I mean, I remember, and this is decades ago, long before there was social media, I don't think there was an internet, where there would be a little bit of ostracization involved in, did I just make up that word? In actually being on one side of the issue or the other. I think as a pro-lifer, I've experienced that first and foremost, most of all. But if you believe it, you'll be able to articulate it, and you'll be able to defend it and explain it. And I don't want to emphasize the word defend as much as I emphasize the word explain. You have an opportunity to tell people how you came to that conclusion. Because I bet that there are as many viewpoints, as many life's experiences, and as many motivators as to what compels you to be a conservative than there are people in this room. So tell people. For some of you, maybe you're pro-life. For some, it's school choice and charters. For others, it's national security. For others, it's taxes. Others, it's repealing Obamacare. Others, it's you feel the culture is so coarsened and so politically correct that it bothers you, and you don't want that. It could be for any reason at all, but for whatever reason it is, be willing to tell your story, because people will look at you. I want to repeat it. I like you, and you're like me. You're accessible, you're affable, but also you're a co-student with them right now on the campus. You're in the place of worship where they go. You're in the community. You're part of a larger peer group that got invited to some event together, so you're a friend of a friend of a friend, and you meet other people. And that is, I think, the most effective way to grow and deepen this movement of ideas.
Thank you. Boy, do we all need to hear that, and whether we're on campuses or not. Now, here's something I didn't know about Kellyanne, and I don't think you all probably know it either unless you really study your Wikipedia page.
God, I hope I know.
Yeah, you do.
Oh, Wikipedia is probably definitely
I know, it's probably wrong. Yeah, somebody made that up. So for 8 summers, you worked on a blueberry farm.
That is true.
Is that right?
Yes, it is.
So you guys, I hate to tell you, but you're called the entitlement generation. So whether that's right or wrong, Kellyanne, you know, schlepped away. I think you won like the best packer award.
It was the fastest because you got paid by the crate. So we had to put the cellophane into the crate and 12 pints for a crate. So I was the fastest because the faster you were, the more you got paid.
Awesome.
And so I learned to do that. I was a little bit of a maniac
right
about
then.
It, yes.
Well, that's good.
But,
we like
know,
that.
I said somewhere in an interview, and it got covered quite a bit, thankfully, Kate, that so much of what I learned about hard work and camaraderie, I learned on that farm, because I started working on it when I was 12, and yes, you were allowed. I think we've been outsourced to machines now in that position, but yes, you were allowed to be, and many of my friends worked, and we worked really hard, but we learned so much about teamwork and, honestly, the tax code, because even then we had to pay them. But I'm all for, you know, this is a time in your life, if I may give you unsolicited advice, where you can try things and not make a full commitment, that's your total career path. Go take an internship in something that you've never actually thought you might like. It's a great way to figure out in 8 or 10 weeks whether you do or you don't. The advice I would give, because I'm sure there are other things I wanted to do in the summers, and I was hardly like supporting the family with my summer job on the blueberry farm, but I did it because I looked at it as an opportunity to say yes instead of saying no. And I've been trying to say yes, even though I tell women all the time, especially, saying no is a gift you give to yourself, ultimately. But it's because we tend to overextend ourselves. But saying yes, opportunity does not always knock twice. So I always remember when I was younger, especially when I was building my business, Kate, that I would try to listen and accept the word no more often than I said it. And all that means is that you will be rejected, you will be passed over, you won't get into that grad school of your dreams, you won't get the job you think you're perfectly qualified for, and maybe it's not fair. But accept it and learn from it and go on. Everything's a lesson. But don't say the word no. I see people say the word no, it's like, oh, I don't know, I'm tired, I didn't work out this week, I already have plans this week. And if you're being asked to do something, volunteer your time, or be the person who literally goes the extra mile and travels for work or is being asked to stay late, just do it. To the extent you can do it, just do it, because you will be seen as somebody who's dependable and reliable and pleasant and there for the team, there for the ultimate objective. And if you're seen as somebody, if you're marked as somebody who's willing to always go the extra mile and help out and be pleasant about it, then you'll be seen as that person, even though there won't always be an opportunity for them to have to ask you to stay again or work on the weekend. I've learned so much from the times that I said yes instead of no, and I've often regretted the times that I said no because of all the other reasons I mentioned, which didn't even matter in the end. I always say to people, don't be afraid, because what's the worst? The worst thing that can happen is somebody will say no, or you'll find out that they're a miserable person, and that's all right and all right. We might as well just know who's miserable. Don't be afraid to call mom's college roommate's cousin who works here in Washington in patent law if you think you want to be a patent lawyer, or who worked on the Energy and Commerce Committee in the Senate for many years because you think you may want to do an internship or get a full-time job on Capitol Hill. Don't be afraid to call them. You should contact them and say, I would love 15 minutes of your time. Sometimes it doesn't work out. Sometimes they're not available. But often somebody would rather spend an hour with you than the 15 minutes just to find out. And you're incredibly helpful to them because they're going to learn something about your generation and the aspiration and the energy and the entrepreneurialism I just find in your generation, really the moxie on many things. And then you're going to learn from them. But making those connections is incredibly important because it's a way to learn from somebody without who's not in charge of giving you the job or the internship but can guide you. But I always tell people, call me, because if I can just say, yeah, I know someone who knows someone who knows someone, and we can all be each other's connectors, the left is really good about doing this. And so we need to be good about it too.
All right, well, sticking sort of a little bit with the personal, you are counselor to the president. I mean, that is huge. You talked a little bit about Donald Trump and some of his characteristics. What is it like to be in the White House serving as counselor to the president? And then I'm going to ask you a question that the media doesn't let you actually answer, but what are some of the things you're working on? You mentioned the opioid crisis, but what else are you working on?
Thank you very much. So as counselor to the president, my role includes being involved in big, big initiatives as part of a large team like healthcare reform, tax reform. Perhaps today we're going to have the 65th anniversary of the Small Business Administration, for example. Administrator McMahon's doing a great job. She's someone that my team and I work very closely with on a number of different initiatives. Tomorrow, Ivanka Trump and I will be part of a roundtable discussion with military spouses on an issue I work on practically every day, which is military spouse unemployment and underemployment. Great. That we do a great job connecting veterans with, you know, perhaps with to reassimilate and to get employment and skills training as they need it and want it. But we're not so great yet about making sure our military spouses can find work. Here's a very good example. In many places, it's the licensing fees that are the impediment, because if you're already a licensed hairdresser or a nurse and you try to move because of you're just moving to a different base and your spouse, normally a man, is deployed and you want to be employed here, you have to go and get a license in that state, and it's cost prohibitive and you have to wait and there's a lot of hassle and there's no guarantee. So to even look at that, the $500 licensing fee, for example, which is groceries or childcare, instead of having, you're already qualified, you're already credentialed, you're already working. So trying to work with governors and employers on matters like that. The opioid crisis, I definitely work on every day because no state has been spared and no demographic group untouched. And we, through a couple of different initiatives, are really trying to destigmatize what is becoming what is truly a national epidemic. Yesterday's interim report recommended that the president consider declaring a national health emergency the way it was done with AIDS and with Zika years ago. But we also, on opioids, really to help with supply and demand, both are out of control, interdiction, treatment and recovery, prevention, those different strategies. I take a lot of meetings with outside groups, small business groups, non-for-profit groups, folks who have been working on issues for years and feel like they finally have the ability, perhaps, to be heard and want to share with us the information, the research they've done, the information, the ideas they have. Work with our legislative team when they need me to go to Capitol Hill and help them. My friend Mark Short, the vice president, whose pollster and strategist I was for 10 years before he became the vice president. So I'm a terrible matchmaker, but I'm glad those two are together, for sure. And Donald Trump and Mike Pence. Also, I try to support whatever we're doing with respect to the workplace and with women, which other people work on as well. Obviously, Ivanka Trump takes the lead on that. And then I support what our press and comms shops are doing. I'm not formally part of press and comms, but I do help to oversee the strategy and the deployment in press and comms and support that every day also. About 2% of what I do is going TV or radio.
Really?
It's,
wow.
Well, it's because that's just sort of in and out.
Yeah.
It's, there's so much else to do. But I'm happy to really support the initiatives and what I'm being asked to work on. I'm a big protocol and pecking order, deferential kind of gal. So I'm really happy that we have that at the White House. And you asked me a question about what is it like to work there?
Right.
So with gravity and responsibility should come a great deal of humility. I told the president last week that I really feel the people who prosper and can do the strongest and the longest in his administration are those who, if they can stay, some people have to leave for other reasons, family or money concerns, et cetera, are those who are tough but humble. And I do believe humility is so incredibly important when you're serving the country. And it's incredibly important when you are representing the president and the vice president and the administration. And humility is, that is something very infectious, actually. Mm-hmm. And so I always stay focused on why we're there. And I stay focused on the fact that many people either don't know what's being done there or don't want to know. I'm somebody who doesn't really talk about biased coverage so much as incomplete coverage. So I've said if the media don't want to acknowledge their responsibility to be fair and to keep an open mind and not be so presumptively negative about the president and his administration, if they're not going to acknowledge their responsibility, they ought to at least acknowledge their role. They have a role in connecting America with the information America needs. What has been done for our veterans in the first couple short months? The Veterans Choice Act, so that a veteran can access private care if he or she can't find timely quality care through the VA, and most say they can.
Right.
The Accountability and Whistleblower Protection Act, the authority of Secretary Shulkin at the VA, which he has executed on to fire people, over 700 now have lost their jobs. This entire 24/7 hotline at the White House for veterans. So if you've never heard this before, it's not because you don't turn on the news or read. I know you do and you do. It's because nobody's talking about it. And so it means our veterans may not know about it.
Right.
So my whole point is connect America with the information they need. I know it's more fun and it's a lot easier to just sort of cover the personalities and the palace intrigue and the tweets. But don't you also want to, or isn't it your responsibility indeed, to tell Americans that the Dow Jones has had, you know, stock market has had a 26 record highs since he got here, over 800,000 jobs created, a multi-billion dollar investment just last week by Foxconn in Wisconsin. Don't you want people to know that the home builders' confidence, consumer confidence, small business confidence, manufacturers' confidence is way up? People are spending their money again. Businesses are hiring again. The unemployment rate is 4.1 or 4.4%. It's low. And don't we want people to know that the second quarter GDP was up 2.6%? It had doubled the first quarter. And if you don't know that, I know it's not because you're not smart, you are, not because you're not well-read, you are, not because you're, it's because it's just not being covered. So that's not a complaint. That's just me asking you to help us get the message out as great messengers and ambassadors on your own college campuses and in your own communities. The other thing is, working in the White House, I've said like one of 300 people representing a country, or maybe one of 330 people representing in the White House, in the West Wing, in a country of 330 million people. So there's a certain just complete blessing, unexpected, be raised by a single mom and a house full of four women who raised me. And, you know, I grew up very middle class, maybe, but I grew up with God and country and family is number one. We never talked about politics. I don't remember a single political conversation in my life. And we had pictures of the Last Supper and the Pope on the wall, not of Reagan or Kennedy, I assure you. But to be raised to give more than you take, to be humble, to believe in God, to rely on family and friends, to recognize that the government is there to help and to help temporarily, to help those truly in need more permanently, and that and to really have faith in your own belief system and be willing to articulate that. And I saw yesterday somebody made the remarks, and it's so true, that it's so different in this country where you pledge allegiance to or you take an oath of office. You pledge your fidelity to the Constitution, not to a monarch. Not to a political party, to the Constitution, and it's important. I'm sure many of you have memorized it and can defend it and explain it as well. So that's incredibly important when you walk through that door as well. And every day we just want to do a good job. And I work for a president for whom the basic political motivators just didn't apply. Power, right. Greed, money, prestige, position, bankability. Come on, he had all that. And he and his family have sacrificed enormously. To do this. So I appreciate the fact that our president and our vice president are sacrificing so much to do these jobs on behalf of a country that we all love. And I know that there are critics and naysayers and indeed haters out there, so I usually just say a prayer for them. What can I do? I usually just say a prayer for them. But remember, I forget who said it, but he or she was right. Nobody can make you feel badly without your permission, and so far I haven't granted it.
That's great. I really hadn't heard a lot about what was being done for veterans' wives. You very rarely do you hear any politicians talking about that. What a huge issue. So you've talked about some of the untold successes. Any untold stories you want to share with us?
Oh, my.
What's going on? Not intrigue, but just anything, you know, anything you've seen with the president and your average Americans out there and...
Very much so. I'm glad you asked that. Well, two things. One is I do go out on behalf of the White House quite a bit, and I would say there's so much more support for the president than is reflected either in the polls or in the coverage, and that should matter because people are getting information and seeing results somewhere, somehow. So I always have faith in the wisdom of people, and people will come up to me everywhere. And they invariably say one or a combination of the following. Please tell the president, we love him, he's doing a great job, we see it. We're praying for him, praying for all of you. Keep at it, don't give up. Ignore this one, ignore that. And people also, though, Kate, will come up and say, I didn't vote for him, and I didn't much care for the campaign he ran, or whatever they're telling me, or whatnot. But I want him to succeed, or I like that he's keeping his word, or I like what he did on this issue or that issue, or how he helped this person or that person. So even, I think, if the naysayers would just say, what can you do on behalf of the country? You know, where we couldn't get any Democratic support on any of these big initiatives. I mean, that's a shame. You have to, it really is. I think you have to really open it up for people. And the president, last week, I traveled with him to Ohio, for example, last Tuesday, to Youngstown, Ohio, a place where I was on Labor Day last year, September 5th, with Governor Pence and Mr. Trump, and at the end of our day, our last stop was going to be a county fair in Canfield County, Ohio, if anybody lives near there, the Youngstown area. And they were supposed to do an interview with ABC News' David Muir, and ABC made this beautiful, beautiful scene on a hill, and it's going to be so wonderful. And we got there to this county fair, and as we're pulling up, with the three of us in the car, and we're pulling up. It's a good story, actually, for you. And we're pulling up, and I'm on two phones, and I'm typing things, and I'm, kind of listening, and I hear Governor Pence say to Mr. Trump, hey, Donald, I've got this. County fair? I'm the governor of Indiana. I was a congressman. I grew up with a cornfield in the back. I was a congressman for 12 years. I know my lemon freezes. I know my corn dogs. I know my, he's talking about some of the games, and he said, I've got this. We showed up to a county fair, And there were just, I heard one report, 80,000 people there. It certainly felt that way. The Secret Service would not allow the president and vice president to do their interview on the Hill because it wasn't swept for an 80,000 person event. It was a county fair. And I looked at that on September 5th and I said, how in the world are we going to lose Ohio? It didn't feel that way. But I listened to the people that day and they all looked very happy. They were standing shoulder to shoulder, 8 and 10 deep. The SUV, the thermometer in the SUV said 86 degrees outside. They had been standing there for quite a while. And they weren't saying, please sign this autograph. Right. I loved you on The Apprentice. They would say, please help us get jobs back to this area. Thank you for loving the country and for putting the veterans first. Thank you for saying you're going to put ISIS in retreat. Hillary Clinton had referred to them as our, quote, determined enemies at the convention in Philadelphia. I don't know what that is, like determined enemies, the other lacrosse team. I don't know what that is. What is that? But I listened to the people, and we have great stories like that all the time, but I want to tell you, when I watched the president in Youngstown return to the same area last Tuesday as president, I think the affection and respect for him and the hope in him has just intensified because now he can execute on that program. But when I listen to the people, whenever you watch him at a rally, listen to the biggest applause lines. It's really build the wall, cut taxes, repeal Obamacare. He ran on an agenda, on a program that they love. And the one thing I will tell you, I don't think he'd mind me sharing, is just how much he loves and honors the job he has. When I see him invite people into the Oval Office to take a picture, he'll ask them, he'll have this very serious roundtable policy, everybody's discussing big issues in the Roosevelt Room, and he's 10 steps away from the Oval Office. And invariably, he invites the entire group in to look at the office, to have a picture with him. It takes all of 8 minutes, and the people are happy, but he asks them, have you ever been invited in there? And people are like, no. Really, you've never been in there? It's just 10 steps away. But it's him sharing the people's house with the people. And we've had people in there, everybody from CEOs to Obamacare victims to coal miners came in. I mean, I can name 40 different instances where that's been the case. And I do want to relay that to you because it is your house. And it's one that, it's a job that he honors and a place he loves to share with the public when he can.
Thank you. Kellyanne, I just want to, on behalf of, I think, everybody.
Young people.
No, I'm your age, so sorry, I can't do that. Jealous. But on behalf of Young Americans Foundation, I know Ron back there feels the same way I do. We just thank you, first of all, for being a stalwart in the conservative movement, for being such a powerhouse in our movement for all these decades. Sorry, but we've been around for a couple of decades.
We've been around a long time.
I know.
It pays to be old, I'm saying. And I'm remiss in not saying one thing.
You said it.
This mother of six. Hello. We're, you know, between of us, we have 10 children, so this is the way we're fighting the demographic wars,
by the way.
Just going to birth our way. Just going to birth our way out of it. I just wanted to say something I've said before, but it's worth repeating here. I consider myself a product of my choices, not a victim of my circumstances. And being a product of your choices means if you want to be a stay-at-home mom or dad, if you want to go be a CEO of a Fortune 100 company, if you want to go be president of the United States, and ladies, first female president, the job is still open.
That's right.
We left it open for you. I told my 7-year-old that day, and she goes, okay, mommy, and ran to the ice cream man. It's cute, on the beach. But do what you want to do, and be who you want to be. And I just have to say that because the greatest professional blessing of my life is certainly to work for the president and for the people of this great nation that I love so much, that's given so much to me. But the greatest privilege, blessing of my life, is not to work for the president and in the White House. It's to be a mother of these 4 children whom I adore. And I just, there's so much talk today. Everybody tries to control their lives. Good luck with that if you're ever gonna be a parent. They try to control their lives, and I'm gonna plan to do this, and then I'm gonna do that, and da, 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 da. Just know who you are. Thank people for their unsolicited advice and be true to yourself and your goals and your dreams and your aspirations because you can have it all, just not all at the same time. And I really don't want an entire generation discouraged by all the negativity and all the you must choose and all the you can't afford that or that's not worth it or don't you just want to. You know who you are. and whether you choose to work, not to work, be a parent, not be a parent, that is the essence of why you are blessed to be in the United States of America, where democracy and freedom and individual liberty and choices prevail. So God bless you.
On that note, thank you, Kellyanne Conway.
Thank you.
Let's keep it going. Let's keep it going for Kellyanne Conway and Kate Obenshain. All right, guys. We are going to take a quick break to reset the stage. But those of you up front, if you don't mind, staying in your seats. But we'll take a very short break, about 2 minutes to reset the stage, and we'll be right back with you.
Of old, the legends and the myths, Achilles and his gold, Achilles and his gifts, and Spider-Man's control, and Batman with his fist. And clearly I don't see myself upon that list. But she said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss, just something I can turn to, somebody I can kiss. I want something just like this. Do 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 do. Oh, I want something just like this. Testaments they told, the moon and its eclipse, and Superman unrolls the suit before he lifts. But I'm not the kind of person that it fits. She said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss, just something I can turn to, somebody I can miss. I want something just like this. I want something just like this. Oh, I want something just like this. Where'd you wanna go?